the Fueled by Death guest.
Starting the show off, kind of, I want to get into what you do as a podcaster, because that's very exciting as well. But you also, you know, are a stand-up comedian, and I'm always curious, talking to comedians, as to what sparked in them the idea that they wanted to get up in front of people and desperately try to make them laugh. What made you get into that game and want to be a stand-up comedian?
The answer that is less exciting is a terrible childhood and a survival reaction. The answer that's slightly more exciting is I was always a fan of comedy, and especially sitcoms and stand-up, and growing up in the 80s when stand-up was ubiquitous on television because it was very cheap and it was on every single channel, I kind of got a crash course, like many of us did, in sort of stand-up structure and how it worked and all that sort of thing. And then I was in a punk rock band for years when I was a teenager, so I kind of got used to getting up on stage and booking shows and sort of hustling that way. So when that sort of dissolved, I finally decided I'll just try to do stand-up.
Nice. What'd you play?
I sang. I'm making air quotes as I say that. And played a little bit of guitar.
Nice.
How much do you find that... You talked a little bit about how that helped you transition into a comedian, fronting a band. Can you talk a little bit more about that, how that was going from a lead singer of a band to a comedian?
It's never what you think it will be, because when you're in a band, you know, you tell a joke in between songs or make a crack and you get a huge laugh because everyone there presumably likes you and they're also not expecting it.
Right.
And then you go on stage as a comedian and go, oh, it'll be just like talking between songs. And then it's not like that at all. And you realize that it is a real sort of arsenal. You have an arsenal of tools in a band to win over an audience, like cover songs. And people can watch bands and go, well, I didn't really like the band that much, but their guitar player was great. Or, you know, they did one song I really liked, and people don't watch comedy that way.
Yeah.
it's definitely a shock when you start doing stand-up. But at the same time, with stand-up, you can change the direction you're going mid-bit, which you can't really do in the middle of the song.
That's true.
And, you know, you don't have to worry about other people, and you don't have to load gear in and out, which is nice. I've been hit by a brick doing both stand-up and music, so
goodness,
that's a commonality between the two. But
God, who throws bricks? Where were you? Were you in the same place?
In the band, we got booked on a show in southern New Jersey that ended up being in a log cabin, and it was us. Ooh. And the other bands were all white power skinhead bands. Which I should mention, we were not. So I made an executive decision that we would play non-ironic Prince covers for our set. And about 25 seconds into I Want to Be Your Lover, I got hit with a brick. Doing stand-up, that's happened as well. Because when I started doing stand-up when I lived in London, and when I moved back to Boston, I didn't really know anyone who did stand-up here, and I only knew people in bands. So I was doing stand-up opening for bands, which is the worst place to do stand-up.
Yeah, it seems like that would be... I've seen it happen a few times at shows that Jeff and I have played, and it's been like, yeah, no, this isn't going to work. Nobody likes that.
No, I mean, they listen to music and listen to comedy in two totally different ways. Like, comedy, you have to pay attention, and it's very active. And you know, there's also especially a lot of people who aren't going specifically to see a comedy show have an adversarial relationship with the comedy show, because they're already like, oh, you think you're funny? Yeah, prove it. Oh yeah. And so you're already, you know, that's two strikes against you when you're up there opening for a band. And so it's difficult, because with a band, people can like talk to a girl, or like half pay attention, or, you know, whatever it is. They never work.
I feel like there's a big difference between people sitting and watching comedy and standing and watching comedy, and the same thing with music. And it's kind of like opposite with music. You want everybody standing up, watching, and maybe dancing a little bit. And comedy, you most definitely want people sitting. And I think a standing comedy room is always just a bit odd.
Yeah, I mean, I think one's sort of more physically interactive and one's sort of more mentally interactive.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You can't really do both at the same time.
Yeah.
I have a lot of respect for comedians because, like Dustin was saying, both himself and myself are musicians. We've played in bands together, and that's something that I enjoy. But watching, like, you guys get on stage and, you know, desperately trying to win over a crowd, like you were saying, that's something that I have a lot of respect for. And you mentioned that you're from Boston and you grew up, with the comedy boom in the 80s, which it was when television kind of was like, okay, comedians are where the money's at. And, you know, we're going to make sitcoms out of it. We're going to make, you know, stand-up was on every single night on every channel. You could see it all over the place. But growing up in a place like Boston, that's a big comedy city. Were you immersed in that culture at all when you were younger?
A little bit. Like, it was hard not to absorb it a little bit here. So we had three sort of big waves of comedy. The first one being the first real comedy boom we had here was at a place called the Ding Ho, which was a Chinese restaurant in Cambridge, Mass. Mm-hmm. And there's a great documentary about it called When Stand Up Stood Up. But the people who started there was like Stephen Wright, Lenny Clark, Bobcat Goldthwait towards the end, Tom Kenny, who's SpongeBob SquarePants, a lot of those people. And then the second wave, which is kind of all the mainstream comedians that we have now, all started at a place called Catch a Rising Star in Cambridge. And that was Mark Maron, Louis C.K., Laura Keitlinger, Gene Garofalo, David Cross, a lot of Mr. Show people. Mm-hmm. They all started out of there. And then in the late 90s, early 2000s, when I was starting, I kind of came in on the tail end of the comedy studio boom, which was Larry Murphy, Jen Kirkman, Eugene Merman, Patrick Borelli, Brendan Small, speaking of someone who's in bands and does comedy.
Yeah.
So that was sort of the last wave. So I as I got older, I was more aware of it because I was going to more shows. But like the Catch a Rising Star boom in the mid 80s, I used to hang around in Harvard Square a lot, and I was too young to get into the club, but they had a speaker on the sidewalk and to sort of entice people to come in. And I would just kind of stand under the speaker and listen to the shows.
Oh, cool.
So, I was a little bit aware, as much as I could be.
Right. You also mentioned that you lived in London for a little bit. Is there a difference in the comedy scene over in the UK than it is in America?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I haven't been back in a while, but it definitely always has been different. Historically, in the 80s, while we were having that sort of brick wall, pushed up sleeves, what's the deal with comedy boom, they had what we would call an alt comedy boom. It was sort of the front runners of which were all the guys from the show The Young Ones.
Yeah,
and they really, alt comedy became the mainstream there. So their mainstream comedy is much stranger and weirder and smarter and was more character based and just stranger. So they were generally more used to weirder stuff. And not so much observational stuff. And I like that.
Cool.
And so the other thing was, though, that when I started there, and I don't do that much pop culture stuff in my act now, even though my podcast is all that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't mean it's all that, like, you know,
like
dope,
the show, all that.
Yeah. it's just a podcast where I reenact all the episodes of all that. I have the scripts and I play all the parts.
Woof.
But and I incorporate a little bit of that in my act now, but when I started in London, obviously it's difficult to do that from a culture that didn't grow up with what you did. So it kind of made my stand-up more focused on sort of stories about growing up and more sort of universal stuff.
Yeah.
And when people heckle you over there, it's not like you suck, you're gay, like it is here in Boston, which I think people still yell. actually, by the way, it's fine if I was, but that's what people yell. But it's like very pointed, observant heckles, like, "Ah, it's not logical," or like, "That doesn't check out," it's much more, it's almost helpful heckles there.
Yeah.
Constructive criticism yelled out in a British accent. "You could wear better knickers."
Yeah.
That's funny. And right before we get into your podcast, I actually was listening to some recent episodes on your podcast, and you brought up something that I wanted you to talk about a little bit on our podcast. You recently said, I think it was on your newest episode, that you believe, and I've never heard anybody say it like this before, that comedy and horror are basically like sisters of each other. The genres Absolutely. Are sisters of each other. Can you speak on that a little bit? I think that's very interesting.
Yeah, they're identical in structure. The only difference being the payoff. So you know, I always bring it up in the context of Stephen King's book Dance Macabre, mm-hmm. which I always recommend that anyone who wants to write anything reads, but especially anyone who wants to do comedy, because he really gets into the structure of horror. And part of the big revelations he has in that book is that that context is a big deal. So he uses the clown at midnight sort of example, mm-hmm. where, and a lot of people wouldn't agree with this now, but a clown at the circus is funny, a clown on your lawn at midnight is terrifying.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the inverse is true as well. So like a serial killer at a circus is funny, you know? But on your lawn is scary. That's the context it's supposed to be in. So in that way, they're sisters, but also it's that buildup and release. It's the same exact structure and timing and function, just with, like I said, a different sort of button on the end. And I always try to bring it up for new comics when they ask me, God forbid they ask me, because you have shock jokes. So like, you know, a Nazi joke or rape joke, or, you know, that a lot of people do when they first start.
Right.
Because it gets a reaction. But that's the joke equivalent of, you know, throwing a cat at someone in a horror movie. Like, everyone's going to jump. But then it's sort of at the expense of the rest of the movie. They don't trust you anymore.
Yep.
And they're kind of mad that you made them react. Whereas if you build real character, if you build real story, they're invested in what happens to that character. And if it's something funny, they laugh a lot harder and they think about it a lot longer. If it's something scary or terrible, they feel it much more deeply. And it's exactly the same. Which is why when, you know, horror comedies work, they're people's favorite movies.
Yeah.
It's almost like two sides of the same coin. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's an interesting thought. I had never really thought about it before. But then, you know, when you even boil it down to the reaction that you get from either genre, they go hand in hand. Like, a lot of times, you know, like a jump scare in a horror movie will immediately make you, like, you know, gasp and be scared. And that's almost always followed by a giggle. You're almost always, like, relieved after the fact, you know? And the kind of the same thing happens, you know, like with a shocking joke, like, you know, like...
Or even, like, slapstick comedy.
Yeah.
Slapstick comedy is kind of like the... Like, if horror was extra gory,
yeah,
you know, it's like very heavy handed and like, yeah, that makes sense.
If you look at a movie like Dead Alive or Evil Dead 2,
mm-hmm.
I mean, that's slapstick comedy,
right?
But so over the top gory that it becomes slapstick comedy. And, you know, and the reason we have comedy and horror, I think, are the same. It's the sort of cathartic release from terrible things.
Yeah.
You know, you depower scary things when you laugh at them or when you put rules around them or sort of contain them in a story or a movie. And I always feel like, you know, that's why they're good representations of sort of the psyche of a culture at the same time. And I'm also a huge horror fan, which is probably evident by that fact. But, you know, I think that's why they're sort of sister genres.
That
makes sense, man.
It really does.
So when are people going to start doing stand-up horror?
Oh, I've seen it every week. people intentionally do it, but I actually did have an idea for a stand-up horror movie, and it was about, because stand-up comedians, when they're off stage, tend to be pretty unremarkable and travel around a lot and don't talk to anyone ever.
Right.
It was someone who was a stand-up comedian but was also a hitman.
Ooh. I like it.
Serial killer. It could be either one, but they just sort of travel from town to town, you know, and murder people on stage and off.
When I'm thinking stand-up horror, I'm thinking more like that scene in Interview with a Vampire where they eat that girl on stage.
Oh.
Something more like that.
A Grand Guignol kind of thing like that.
Touring the country, just eating people on stage.
Yeah.
All right. I like where this is going. I think these are good ideas. So the other side of you that at least is known to the public is your podcasting side. And I'm really, really interested in your podcast, which I'm going to hopefully not murder this. It's the TV Guidance Counselor podcast, correct?
Yeah.
That started from your collection of TV Guide. And I'm a collector, too. I've been collecting comic books my entire life.
Right.
And I know the allure of collections, but I think that's quite the odd one to start. And you, correct me if I'm wrong, you started this at a young age collecting TV guides, correct?
Oh, yeah, probably 2 or 3 years old, yeah.
Whoa.
Now,
but I also was collecting comics then, too.
Where did the TV guide collection kind of come from? What sparked that in you?
We used to get it at our house, and I started reading very early, and I loved television, and I realized that they would deliver this thing in the mailbox every Wednesday, and I could sit down and sort of get a preview of what was going to be on in the next week, and I could sit down and plan my week. And in the age before everyone had a VCR and DVRs, you know, it was a way to do it. And especially with horror movies, because you would look to the movie section in the back, and there was a lot of movies that you couldn't see anymore, weren't on video, were hard to see, so you would make a note to watch them. Yeah. And so I would look through the TV guide from cover to cover that way. And I also realized that it had very informative articles and really interesting sort of futurism stuff about technology coming out, and very insightful media criticism and reviews of things. And that was very helpful as well. And because you can only kind of watch one thing at a time, there were shows I couldn't watch that I could read about, and it was almost like watching them. So I was sort of really into it for that reason. And then we didn't have a lot of money when I was growing up, so I would make my own money. Actually, my first sort of major money-making scheme was I used to buy and flip comic collections when I was 8, 9 years old, and had a decent amount of money from it.
Nice.
And I would pay for my own subscriptions, and I kind of just held on to them. And then in the 90s, late 90s, there was two libraries. One was in Maine and one was in Nebraska, I think, that were getting rid of all their physical periodicals in favor of microfiche or digital something. And so I took all their collections. So I had them. And they're fun because I when people would ask me before I started doing the podcast, they'd say, why do you have all these TV guides? And I would joke and say alibis. But where was I on the night of June 5th, 1980?
I was watching
Barney Miller, and I'll tell you exactly what happened. But it is kind of interesting, these things that were made to be disposable, these things that were made to only be relevant for 1 week, end up being the most accurate, insightful snapshot of a time and a place. And when you start to look at them, this sort of cultural picture of the time really, you know, begins to come into focus. And that's very interesting to me.
Yeah. It's kind of weird, you know, listening to you talk about it, and I'm kind of drawing a parallel with music nowadays, because same thing with movies, everything's on demand, and you can just listen or watch anything you want at any point in time. And you talking about TV guides kind of reminds me of how it was when you bought an album,
right?
And you took the time, yeah, and you sat down and you flipped through the album, or maybe the radio was enticing and you just wait for your favorite song to come on.
There's
and
tape songs off the radio.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And it's,
well, you were invested. You were invested. So when you know, people are used to things for free now, but with movies and television and music, you know, I always say there's a lot of albums that people recommended to me that I bought and I hated.
Mm-hmm.
But because I bought it, I sat down and I listened to that thing until I liked it. And often those end up being some of my favorite albums ever. It took 4, 5, 6 listens all the way through for it to kind of click.
Yeah.
And movies the same way. You know, if you rented a movie, you plunk down your $3, you're going to sit and watch the whole movie, even if the first 20 minutes is bad. Now someone just flips to a new movie on Netflix. And so people were exposed to more stuff. They were invested in more things. And there's also a thrill of, with radio and television, with something just coming on, just stumbling on things.
Yeah.
Like, one of the things I always talk about is, you know, when I was 5 years old, I also had horrible insomnia when I was a kid. I slept maybe 2 hours a night. And I was watching MTV at like 11 o'clock at night, and the Young Ones came on and the Damned were on.
Yeah.
And I didn't know what it was, but it was that moment where you go, this is everything I like in the world right now. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I'm into punk rock. There's a vampire singing a song. This show is great. you know, and it's a complete, you know, it's serendipity. I just happened to stumble on it. I didn't seek it out. And that's one of the things I think we lose now. In addition to that shared experience, like all of us that grew up pre-millennium, no matter what we're like now or where we stand on things now, we all have the shared experience of pretty much watching the same shows.
Yeah.
And there's a value to that. Whereas now, you know, I often wonder what younger people's shared experience is. And it's like, cat videos are like national tragedies.
Yeah. I've wondered the same thing, because we're all roughly the same age, and we're all products of that TV generation. And like, and I, you know, I remember growing up through the 80s, it was something that wasn't talked about. And then into the 90s and even into the 2000s, it was something that was lambasted, and people were like, you know, you know, you grew up with television, and television was the babysitter.
We had three channels.
Yeah. And television was terrible for you. But, you know, you look back on it now, and you just touched on it. It was a shared experience. Like, TV Guide wasn't just the ability to go and see what was going on for the week. It was, you know, in a lot of households, it was you know, you would have one television, so it was your family time. You know, it was like, okay, you know, like, we're going to all sit around and watch this television show or this movie that's going to be on cable because it's something that, you know, we can all enjoy together. And then those become those shared experiences. And I'm the same thing with you. I wonder, you know, what is it? What is galvanizing this generation, you know, because they don't have that.
Netflix shows, viral videos.
But are they
Snapchat
all,
filters.
Are they all watching the same thing, all doing the same thing? You know,
It's I guess when they like live tweet things, or I mean, that's why you see television really push more towards live events, like those live musicals, you know, shows like American Idol and sporting events, because those are the only thing that people feel like they need to watch then and there, day and date.
Right.
But, you know, I think we have lost a lot of things. Like, television is a very intimate medium because it's pumped into your house. And you watch it in your environment. So it's a shared experience that's also very intimate, which is a very odd combination of things.
Yeah.
And also, like, I feel like a generation has lost the ability to learn how to bargain for things. Like, when you had multiple people in a house and there was a show you wanted to watch, you had to make a case for it because there's one TV. So you had to learn how to sort of sell a thing to other people. And you also ended up watching a lot of stuff that you maybe didn't like or wouldn't have initially watched because someone else wanted to watch it that you ended up really liking. Man. So sort of being forced to be exposed to a lot of things. And, you know, as a kid who grew up with not a lot of money, I also have to say that although it wasn't technically free, you know, for basically free, I was able to get an education on all kinds of incredible things in movies and documentaries and, you know, things about the world that I would never be exposed to otherwise. Yeah. And I know the internet can do that now, but it's you have to seek it out. It's not just sort of curated for you.
Oh, totally. So you had this collection since you were a young kid. When did the idea to start your podcast kind of like germinate with you?
Probably about 4 years ago. I always wanted to do a podcast, but I didn't really have a good idea, and I didn't want to do another podcast about like comedians talking about comedy.
Right.
Because I feel like, number one, it's not really that interesting to anyone who doesn't want to be a comedian. And two, a lot of people already did it, and a lot of people already did it very well, and it was kind of taken care of. Mm-hmm. And so when people would come over to my house, I have these TV guides in this big spinning rack in my living room. I'm looking at it right now. And they would come over, and inevitably they would be sort of drawn to these TV guides and grab one and flip through and go, oh, hey, remember this show? I forgot about this show. And my friend Sean Sullivan, who's a very funny Boston comedian, one day just said, that's the podcast. Just people, someone picks a TV guide and then you talk about that week. And that's pretty much exactly what the podcast is.
Yeah.
And that's kind of how it started. So I said, that's a great idea. And that's what I did.
I think it's a fascinating idea because, like you kind of touched on earlier, it is a snapshot of time. Like you made the joke, like you could have the alibi, but you really can because, I mean, drawing from my own experience, you know, I grew up with the television and I, not only do I remember, you know, specific shows, but I remember specific episodes, specific things that in my life were happening when, you know, Al Bundy was yelling at Peg or when, you know, like random things like would happen on the TV, but then translate to my life. And that's why I'm fascinated by your show, because I think it's a great idea. And it wasn't something that you had to seek out because you already had the material at your fingertips.
Yeah, I don't think, I think a lot of podcasts have a very artificial premise.
Mm-hmm.
And this is truly something that I love talking about. And I love talking to people. And after, you know, I think I've been doing stand-up 10 or 12 years when I started it. But I realized that I actually enjoy speaking to other people and getting their story a lot more than I enjoy, although I still like doing stand-up, but I like that a lot more than I enjoy the sort of false one-sided conversation of stand-up.
Yeah.
And it's a very different conversation, and I really love it. And to your point, you know, because it's that intimate thing that's in your house, we probably watched the same episode of Married with Children, but you have a very distinct memory of what was going on in your life and in your house at that point.
Right.
And that's very interesting. You know, it's almost like in an American Tale in the Somewhere Out There, you know, we're all underneath the same bright television, you know, we're all doing these kind of things. And it's especially now where it's much easier to find people with common interests to be friends with.
Yeah.
And when we were growing up, your friend base was sort of limited to physical proximity.
Mine was zero.
Yeah. And if you had a common interest, you know, that was unbelievable. But now it's interesting to find people that I've gravitated towards as friends in adult life. and to hear that, oh, we really did watch the same things. We really did have these common interests when we were kids. And that's also kind of a fascinating angle for me.
Yeah, that's really, really fun. So I got to ask then, if you were to pick out a single week, could you do that out of your entire collection? Is there a week that gravitates to you, a TV guide that gravitates to you more than others? I know that's gotta be a mountain of a question.
There's definitely a block of years. So most people, I think, end up picking between ages 8 and 12. That seems to be everybody's sweet spot because you're old enough to have your own taste, but not old enough to like go out or anything.
Right.
And it's also very formative for your sort of interest in that sort of thing. But I would say probably 1990, and there's a TV guide about all the new horror anthology shows and all the new horror shows. It's the Halloween Week TV guide. Ooh. And I love that week because you had the new Dark Shadows, you had Friday the 13th, the series. They focused on the Dracula syndicated series, Tales from the Dark Side, Monsters, Tales from the Crypt had started. It was very much a very specific time for me.
Yeah.
I kind of gravitate towards that. A lot of people end up picking stuff like their birthday week, a holiday. Those tend to be when they remember watching the most stuff.
Right. I think it's interesting, too, because, like, the TV guide then, like you just said, you know, like that one issue, like, it was like Tales from the Crypt was just starting. Like, that becomes a historical document at that point, you know? I mean, like, we forget some of this stuff has been part of the pop culture lexicon now for decades, and you forget that there was moments in time before it existed, you know, and like that sweet spot, like that week when it premiered, it's like, that's fun to think about, like that, you know, like that there's that moment in time that's frozen in that TV guide. It's an interesting thing.
Yeah, I mean, and I'm always fascinated by the fall preview issues because they go through all the new shows starting and they treat them all with the same reverence.
Right.
And it's interesting to see the sort of road not taken because oftentimes they'll say, you know, this show's great. It's going to be the big show. And it was canceled after 3 episodes.
Get ready for the Dana Carvey show. It's coming.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just
it's interesting what they, you know, without hindsight, with foresight, what they thought of these shows. And that's always very interesting to me.
Yeah. That's amazing. So one question we ask every single week of everybody that we talk to on our podcast is this question of, you are someone who, you know, has grown up with the idea of TV as, you know, your friend, it's kind of shaped and molded you along with the TV guide. And then that has also led to your love of punk rock, of horror, and also your other career of stand-up comedian and all that. What fuels you to keep getting out there and doing this kind of stuff, to keep getting out there, you know, getting on stage, being that stand-up comedian, but also, you know, coming up with these new ideas like having a podcast and stuff? What fuels you to keep doing the things that you like to do?
Am I supposed to say Death Wish Coffee?
No, not at all. No, in fact, we'll yell at you for saying that.
We'll yell at you and then send you a check.
Well, it's funny you asked me that because every morning I drink Death Wish Coffee. it's a combination of things. I think it's I really love doing it. I mean, it's something I enjoy doing. It doesn't feel like work. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a key to it. Like, I would do this podcast in stand-up if nobody listened. I would still do it. I'm sort of compelled to do it. Sometimes I describe stand-up as like being a werewolf, where you just are like, I'm gonna go do it, lock me up. it's a compulsion. But the other thing is that I get a thrill out of, with stand-up especially, getting a reaction from strangers, a reaction that I wanted to get, an intended reaction. It's sort of a thrill to like control a room of strangers. That sounds very evil, but you're taking them down a path and you're making them react. And that's thrilling. And even if it's not a laugh, you know, whatever it was your intention was.
Right.
And then the other part is that I'm fascinated by, and this is very Cronenbergian, but I'm fascinated by the concept of sort of a verbal virus, in that a lot of my stuff is stories about growing up or my life experiences. And talking about them on stage or on the podcast, they sort of infect people's brains. And so it's like pieces of your life end up living in other people that you don't know, and it sort of spreads out. And that was the same way with bands too. Like, you'd go, and I'm sure you guys have had this, where like the audience is, you know, yelling your lyrics back to you, and you're like, wow, this is something I wrote on a notebook in English class, and now this stranger's yelling it back to me.
Yeah.
It's this weird sort of infection of ideas And I kind of like that, which, again, sounds super creepy.
You're literally just casting a spell.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. You're changing the world with your words.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. With your podcast, do you find, because you were saying a lot of your stand-up is based with, you know, stories about your childhood and growing up and that kind of thing, do you find that having this podcast now that helps you craft your stuff, your material for your stand-up?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I'm talking a couple hours a week, which is always helpful with stand-up. And unlike music, that was one of the other big differences with stand-up. You can't practice it on your own. You have to practice in front of people, which is really strange. Like if you were practicing scales and you booked it as a show and people show up and you're just running through scales,
right?
You know, it's kind of like, what the hell is this? But that's basically what you have to do with stand-up. So yeah. Being able to talk to people, you know, I actually generate a lot more material from talking to people on the podcast than I generally do, you know, working stuff on stage these days. And that's a huge benefit to me and people who don't have to see me work stuff out on stage.
Wow, that's cool. Okay, so let's let everybody know where we can find you. First, your podcast, the TV Guidance Counselor. Where can we find that?
Yeah, you can go to TVGuidanceCounselor.com and it's on there. It's also on iTunes and Google Play and Stitcher and all the usual podcast places.
Excellent.
SoundCloud.
Excellent. Yeah, I'll put up some links for that. And then for you, stand-up, throughout the end of 2017 into maybe 2018, do you have anything that you can talk about where you're going to be or...?
Nothing major.
Right.
They can go to iKenReid.com.
There we go.
iKenReid.com, because KenReid.com was taken by a conservative Southern politician who I occasionally get emails for, and I always answer them. But and at one point was quoted in a local paper, and he was very mad.
Nice.
I love it.
Talk about a verbal virus.
They asked me if I was Ken Reid, and I commented on this. I didn't know why they were asking me about the Loudoun County Teachers Union, but...
Boy, did you have opinions about it.
Yeah, I told them that they can go fuck themselves. And it got attributed to this guy, and he was not happy about it.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah, all my stuff is on there. I also just, TBS just did like a weird three-part little web documentary about me that just started airing today.
Awesome.
So that's up as part of New York Comedy Festival. Yeah, all my shows will be up on iKenReid.com as well.
Excellent, excellent. Well, man, it was really, really fun to talk to you, and thanks for taking time to talk with us on our podcast, and we're going to tell all of our listeners to go check out your podcast, because again, I just love the premise of it. You know, TV is, you know, it molded me into who I am, and
Rangers, man.
Yeah.
I'm like a perfect mix of Power Rangers and HBO's Real Sex.
And you know what? Today you could actually have that mix somewhere.
Exactly.
Probably on the internet.
Exactly. It's ridiculous, but I think it's great that you're like I said, keeping that historical record of this whole entire culture alive and everything. And I think it's great. And I can't thank you enough for being a guest on our show.
Well, thank you so much for having me. It's been great talking to you guys.
Hell yeah.
This has been Fueled by Deathcast, a Death Wish Coffee Company podcast production. Thanks for listening.